हाय एवरीवन, सो द लास्ट टॉपिक इज ओवर, द लास्ट चैप्टर इज ओवर, दैट इज स्टेट्स ऑफ मैटर इज ओवर. देन द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज एक्चुअली थर्मोडायनामिक्स, बट थर्मोडायनामिक्स एंड स्किपिंग आउट एंड वी विल स्टडी लेटर बिकॉज इन फिजिक्स यू हैव थर्मोडायनामिक्स. सो वंस द फिजिक्स टीचर इज डन विद द थर्मोडायनामिक्स, we will see the later portions in thermodynamics like thermochemical equations and all, and that will then entropy, etc. Okay, so once you get an idea, when in physics you will get an idea of what is thermodynamics, what is work done, etc. Then we will what is the energy. Now then we will move on to the rest part of the thermodynamics afterwards. Okay, so today we will see the next chapter, the new chapter, which is equilibrium. Okay, so equilibrium, you know, we are all familiar with the word equilibrium. Now equilibrium means something in a state of stable condition, isn't it? So when you talk about equilibrium in chemistry, normally equilibrium is mainly both, you can see equilibrium or you can have equilibrium in both physical process and also in chemical process. Okay, or even in our body, in metabolism also there is equilibrium happening, like the process of transporting the oxygen and hemoglobin molecule. There is an equilibrium between the oxygen and hemoglobin molecule, where the oxygen is transferred from the lungs to the muscles and all. So everywhere there is an equilibrium happening. Okay, otherwise what happens, the metabolism will not take place accurately. Okay, the enzyme activity in our body is all our equilibrium. The pH conditions in the body, everything maintains an equilibrium. Okay, so talking about more in chemistry, the equilibrium, if you take a small example, if you want to have the concept of equilibrium, what happens in the concept of equilibrium is, equilibrium in chemistry, it always happens in a closed container. Okay, closed container. Closed container means the heat is not given out, or it is not accepted, or energy is not given out, or like that. If it is thermally insulated, then there is no transfer of mass and heat. So in a closed container, if you say there is a liquid, okay, there is a liquid, and if you heat it, you are giving energy. Okay, you are giving energy. You can give energy, so, right, by heating. Now what happens? The liquid, the molecules, if your temperature is increased, what happens to that molecule? The liquid molecules gain kinetic energy, and thereby it starts colliding, and some of the liquid molecules will escape into the gaseous state, isn't it? So some of the molecule will escape into the gaseous state. Correct. Now, as the time goes, or as you increase, as you give the temperature, now what happens? See, first some liquid will collide and it goes to the gaseous state, and then from the gaseous state, gaseous means the vapor, the gas, here it is a gas, correct? So the gas will come and get into the liquid state. Okay, come into the liquid state. So you got the point. Some liquids will go into the gaseous state, whereas at the same time, the gas molecules will come into the, because it is a closed molecule, it have to travel, correct? So some gas molecules will come into the liquid state. And there is a stage at which, a stage is reached at which, what happens? The liquids going into the vapor state and the gases coming into the liquid state is equal. Got it? A stage is reached when the liquid which goes into the vapor state, that means the vaporization, is equal to the number of liquid the molecules going into the vapor state is equal to the number of gaseous molecules coming into the liquid state. Correct. So that stage is called as an equilibrium stage. And normally in this case, we can say the vapor pressure remains constant. This is a liquid gas equilibrium, isn't it? This is a liquid gas equilibrium. I just told you, just to have a hang of it, what is equilibrium? So in this case, the vapor pressure is constant. Vapor pressure means what? You have heard about vapor pressure. I think it is a new word for you, vapor pressure. Vapor pressure is nothing but, in a closed vessel, you know, the gas is coming here. And when it is going back into the liquid, What happens? A pressure is exerted by this gas into its liquid surface, isn't it? The pressure which is exerted by the gas in the liquid. So, in the liquid surface. Okay. So, that pressure is called as vapor pressure. Okay. So, in a gas-liquid equilibrium, what happens? In a gas-liquid equilibrium, the vapor pressure remains constant. Because the number of molecules in the gaseous state will always be constant. So, whatever be the number of molecules in the gaseous state, that gaseous molecules only apply the pressure in the liquid state. So, obviously what happens? The pressure remains constant. So, that pressure is called as vapor pressure. Okay. So, in this case, when we will say an equilibrium, I can say water, H2O, in the liquid state is in equilibrium with water in the gaseous state. So, in this way, I can represent the equilibrium. See, water, both are waters, you can have water, one is in the liquid state and other is in the gaseous state. So, when I represent an equilibrium, the double-headed arrows is needed. That is, double-headed arrows means you have studied, that is a reversible process, isn't it? So, that means what? This will come this and this will come to that side. Exactly, that is a position. So, when we are using the double-headed arrows, when the system is in equilibrium. Correct. So, here the water in the liquid phase is in equilibrium with the water in the gaseous phase. And this mixture in the equilibrium is called as equilibrium mixtures. What is it? Equilibrium mixtures. Okay, now it's an intro of equilibrium. Now we know what is equilibrium and how an equilibrium is attained by the system. Okay, we have discussed the liquid-gas equilibrium. So this is exactly what is equilibrium. Okay, now when we are talking about equilibrium, I already told you that the liquid equilibrium can be seen in both physical processes as well as in chemical processes. Physical processes in the sense physical transformations. For example, solid to liquid, or liquid to gas, or solid to gas. Okay, so we have to study three physical processes equilibria, that is solid liquid, liquid gas, and then solid gas. And also in chemical processes also equilibrium can be seen. Okay, and the reaction may be, and these reactions may be fast or slow. Some reactions are fast and some reactions are slow. So that depends upon the temperature as well as the nature of the reactants, isn't it? So that depends upon the temperature, or it can also depends upon the experimental conditions by which the reaction is following. Okay, so that depends on the temperature. Now, you know, when a reactant, if we say chemical processes, if a reactant is in a closed vessel at a particular temperature, what happens? The reactants at the first or initial stage, the reactants continue to form the products. Now, the reaction is in larger volume because the product is not yet formed. Correct? At the initial stage, when time t is equal to 0. Now, when the reaction starts or happens, what happens? The reaction, the concentration of the reactant slowly decreases, isn't it? Why? That decrease is seen in the increasing of the product. So, what happens? The reactant slowly decreases and the product slowly increases. Now, a stage is reached when the concentration of the reactants is equal to the concentration of the product. So, if we check the concentration of the reactant side, that must be equal to the concentration of the product in the product side, which means what? That means the rate by which a reactant reacts to get product is same as the rate at which the product is going back into the reactant, isn't it? So, if I say a reactant react to give products, and if a dynamic equilibrium, yes, this is called as a dynamic equilibrium. There are two types of equilibrium, there is a static equilibrium as well as a dynamic equilibrium. Static equilibrium means there is no transformations happening in there. Dynamically means what? There is transformations in this because the reactant is going into products and the product is coming back into reactants, isn't it? So at that point of time, we can say it is a dynamic equilibrium. In the same case, in the case of liquid gas equilibrium also, this is a dynamic equilibrium. This is not a static equilibrium. Why? Because at the surface of this liquid gas interface means the point at which the liquid and the gas is there. So at that interface, a lot of activity is happening. That is, the liquids are going into gas, the gas is coming back, the liquids are colliding with the gas molecules, the gas is colliding with the gas molecule, the liquid is colliding with the liquid molecule. So so many activities are happening in this this container or this system. We say the system. So thermodynamics, or we say the system. So you can say that this is a dynamic equilibrium. Okay, so in the chemical processes also, we can say that there is a dynamic equilibrium happening between the reactants and the products, because the rate of the concentration of reactants must be equal to the rate of the concentration of the product when the system is in equilibrium. Got it? Okay. Now we will say, if you talk about more on equilibrium, that there are three, we can classify this reactions into three groups mainly, according to which the extent of reaction is happening to attain the equilibrium. The extent of reaction. So how much reactants are getting converted into product, or are all the reactants converted into product? So according to this, the extent by which the reaction happening can be classified mainly into three groups. Okay. Almost all the 99% of the reactants are converted into products. That is the first group. That is, the whole reactants are converted into products. Only a negligible amount of reactant is left behind, and that too, it cannot be experimentally find out. Okay, so that is, all the reactants are completely going into product. That is the first classification. Second classification is, only a very little amount of reactant is converted into product. That means the reactant is not reacting at all, or the product is not happening. That is the second case. First case, the whole reactant is getting into product. The second case, only a slight amount of reactant is reacting. That means the rest of whole 99% of the reactant is unreacted. That is the second case. It can happen. Okay. When the suitable temperature or pressure or the suitable experimental conditions are not given, it can happen. Now the third classification is, what happens? The reactants, the concentration of the reactants and the concentration of the products are equal. Which means what? An equilibrium condition is attained. So in these three ways we can classify, the extent to which a chemical reaction proceeds. In the first case, the reaction is almost completion. Second case, the reaction is 0% completion. And the third case, the reaction is in equilibrium. That is, the concentration of the reactant is equal to the concentration of the product. And that stage is what we call it as a dynamic equilibrium. Got it? That is called as a dynamic equilibrium. Hope you are clear with the equilibrium concept. Now we will move on to, first we will see some physical equilibria or physical process in equilibria, and then we will move on to the chemical equilibria. Okay. So we will start with physical processes in equilibria. As I told you, the transformations, the phase transformations are mainly studied in physical processes in equilibria. What are the three phases? That is, first is solid and liquid. Okay, phases. Then the liquid and the gas that we have seen, and the third is solid and gas. So these three transformations, that is physical transformation, right? Because it can be converted back. Okay, so this is the physical transformations in which the equilibrium we can see. That is solid, liquid, then liquid. Solid, liquid, liquid, gas, and solid gas. These are the phase transformations we will see in the physical equilibria. Or these are the physical processes in equilibria which we see as the phase transformation. Now first we will see what is solid liquid equilibrium. Solid liquid equilibrium is what? The best example we can take ice and water. If you take ice and water,
and you put this ice and water in a thermally insulated flask or a vessel. You need a closed container. I already told you that equilibrium happens in a closed container. So you take some ice and water in a thermally insulated. What do you mean thermally insulated? Thermally insulated means there is no chance of exchange of heat is taking place. Correct. And there is no difference in mass. You are not adding or taking away from this container. So the mass of the system is always constant and the temperature is always constant. See, three things are constant in this. The mass is always constant because you are not putting or taking something from the container or that system. Then the temperature is kept as constant and the pressure is kept as also as 1 bar. Okay, and the temperature. So if you talk about solid liquid equilibria, we have ice and water. Correct. Now in this equilibrium, we are taking it as a thermally insulated system. Thermally insulated system means what? No exchange of heat. No exchange of heat and matter. Okay. No exchange of heat and also matter. There is no exchange of matter. These two are inhibited. So in that case, you are maintaining this system at a particular temperature. You know, when ice and water can coexist. What is that? Coexist. The ice and water can coexist only at a temperature of 0 degree Celsius or 273 degree Kelvin. Isn't it? And the pressure is 1 bar pressure or 1 atmosphere, whatever you can. Standard. It's a standard temperature and pressure. So this ice and water can coexist or in equilibrium only at a standard temperature and pressure. The temperature is kept as a constant. That is important. The temperature is a constant, that means at 0 degree Celsius or 273 degree Kelvin and 1 bar atmosphere. Now we will see what happens in this. What happens in this? Is there an equilibrium there between the ice and water? Can you say? Is there an equilibrium exist between ice and water? Yes, definitely there is a dynamic equilibrium existing between ice and water. See, if there is ice, if there is both ice and water here, ice here and then water. So water here. What happens? At 0 degree Celsius and 273 degree Celsius, what happens? The ice molecules will melt and form water. Sorry, at that temperature, because 0 degree Celsius, the ice molecules can collide with each other and it will form water molecules. And the water molecules again will come back and form as ice. So there is an equilibrium happening between the ice molecules and the water molecules. Even though if we just normally, if you look into it, we can say that there is no equilibrium, nothing is happening in this system because the mass of the system is constant and whatever ice is there, that much of water is also there in ice and liquid. But still, if you talk about the chemistry of this, we can say that a normal person will say that no, there is nothing happening. Whatever ice is there, whatever liquid, that much liquid is there. So there is no change happening in that system. But when you talk about chemically, we will say there is a dynamic equilibrium existing between this water molecule and the ice. That means the water in the solid state is in equilibrium. How can I write this? How can I write this? The water, here I will write. The water in the solid state, that means ice, is in equilibrium with the water in the liquid state, that is liquid. See, this is solid and liquid equilibrium. Isn't it? So, here at this surface, the interface between the ice and the water, a lot of activity is happening, that is collision, as well as the number of ice or the ice changing into water is equal to the water molecules changing into ice. So at any point of time, there is an equilibrium. And what happens? The mass of the water molecule is always constant and mass of the ice is always constant. But still there is an equilibrium. So how much number of ice is getting converted into water, that much amount of water is converted as ice. So there is no problem. That stage is we call it as dynamic equilibrium stage, in which the solid ice is in equilibrium with liquid water. Hope you understood. Okay. So here at that particular temperature, you said the temperature we kept as a constant, isn't it? So for a pure substance like ice, the temperature at which the ice converts into water, you call it as the melting point of that ice. At the same time, the water gets converting into ice, we call it as freezing point. So that fixed temperature in these equilibria, you call it as the melting point, where the solid ice gets converted into water, and the freezing point where the water gets converted into ice. Okay, so at only at this particular temperature, the solid liquid equilibria happens. Okay, and these two processes happen simultaneously. That means the water converting it into ice and the ice converting it into water takes place simultaneously. That is the process, the forward process is equivalent to the backward process. And also the rate of this reaction, how much speed it is coming, that also is same. Because then only the mass will get same. So this is just what the phase transformation in solid liquid equilibrium. Hope you understood. Very simple. Now we will move on to liquid gas equilibrium. Liquid gas equilibrium we have discussed in the beginning session, isn't it? So once again I will elaborate on that. That is liquid gas equilibrium. Okay, liquid gas equilibrium. So here also what happens? You know, there is a dynamic equilibrium existing between the liquid and the gas. As I said, if you take a closed container or a closed system in which it is liquid, and if you give heat, here you have to give heat. But in the ice water, there is no heat given. Already we have told it is insulated, because when heat is given, what happens? The ice will definitely go into the liquid and then the ice won't be there. So we cannot have an equilibrium there. So here the exchange of heat is there. But so this is a liquid and this is a gas. Now what happens? When you give heat, the kinetic energy of the molecule increases, thereby the liquid molecules are getting into the gaseous state, correct? And after some time what happens? The gaseous molecules will come and go into the liquid state. And the pressure above the liquid is called as, the pressure of the gas above this liquid is called as the vapor pressure. Very important in 10th standard. You are studying the solution chapter, there vapor pressure is coming in between. So it's very, you have to be very clear what is vapor pressure. Now what is vapor pressure? The pressure exerted by to the surface of a liquid is called as vapor pressure. Simple. The pressure of the gas, that's all. Vapor pressure. Vapor state means gaseous state. So the pressure of the gas which is exerted in the liquid surface is called as vapor pressure. Okay, that is, it is getting into gas and coming back into the liquid, it will exert the pressure. So that is simply a vapor pressure. Okay. So then what happens here? Again I told you what the liquid, isn't it? The water is in the liquid state in equilibrium with the water in the gaseous state, isn't it? Here we can say the vapor pressure is a constant. Correct. Vapor pressure is a constant in the liquid gas equilibrium. What happens in a solid liquid equilibria? What is constant? The temperature was constant in that. So for every equilibria, there is one measurable quantity which we kept it as a constant. That is very, very important. In all these equilibria, one measurable quantity. Measurable quantity means temperature, pressure, solubility, etc. So one of this will be kept as a constant and we will do the equilibria there. Okay. So that is, so this is about the, so nothing more to elaborate on that, you know. Okay, so this is liquid gas equilibrium. Okay. Now we will move on to solid gas equilibrium. Okay, solid. The textbook examples are given, so just go through it. Okay, so you will have a very good idea about it. This is just the funda. Okay, and a simple example is also given. So next is solid gas equilibrium. Solid gas equilibrium means what? For example, again in a closed container, you have iodine as solid. Iodine is a solid, right? Iodine is a solid. Okay. Now what happens? If you heat it, If you heat it, what happens? If you heat it, the iodine will straight away form what? Iodine vapors, iodine gas. It is called as sublimation. You know, the process of conversion of a solid directly into liquid without converting it, sorry, directly into gas without converting into solid liquid is called as sublimation. So all sublimable substances will undergo this physical process like solid gas equilibrium. So what happens? First, it will be solid. It will be the reddish brown in color, the iodine. Now, when we heat it, the reddish brown vapors will come. Correct. At the first step, the reddish vapor color will come and it will go to the gaseous state. After some time in that vessel, you can see it will be a transparent vessel. If it is a transparent vessel or a system, we can see the after some time or after a little bit of time, you can see the intensity of the color of that reddish brown comes decreasing, and a stage is reached when the color remains the same throughout the system. That is, an yellowish color remains the same. So, which means that first the iodine, when it is heated in the solid, it comes as a reddish vapor. The intensity is very high. After some time, what happens? The gaseous molecule will again come into the solid state. That is a condensation. So, after some equilibrium is reached, the color of this system will be same. Which means that an equilibrium is attained in this system. Correct? Or you can say, what you can say, iodine in the solid state is in equilibrium with iodine in the gaseous state. So, here there is an equilibrium happening. Okay, any sublimable, for that matter, if it is camphor. But camphor, you cannot see that because camphor, it is colorless vapor, no. So you cannot see that change in the color, the intensity in the color increasing and decreasing. That is why we have taken the iodine, because iodine, reddish brown vapor is first going up. Then afterwards, the intensity of the color decreases and decreases, and finally it will form an yellowish, orangish color, and then that color is remained same for after that. So which means that at that stage we can say that there is no change in color, right? So at that stage we can say that that system is now being in equilibrium. Yeah. Why we are not taking camphor and ammonium chloride? You cannot see the vapors. That is, it is colorless. So in this case we can see, it's a very good example of solid gas equilibrium. Okay. In solid, liquid gas equilibrium, we can say the rate of evaporation must be equal to the rate of condensation, isn't it? That means water in the liquid state is in equilibrium with the water in gaseous state. I have already written that. Water in the liquid state is in equilibrium with water in the gaseous state for a liquid gas equilibrium. Which means what? Which means the rate of condensation. Condensation means what? Condensation means the molecule from the gaseous state comes into the liquid state. That is condensation. What is evaporation? Evaporation means the liquid molecules are going into the vapor state. That is vaporization. So in an equilibrium between a liquid and a gas, you can say that the rate of evaporation, that is how much rate means what? The time. Or the speed, not the time, it is speed. The speed by which a liquid molecule gets converted into a gaseous state is same as the rate of condensation. What is that? That is the speed by which the gaseous molecule condenses to form the, just to make that point. So this is about the physical processes equilibria, the three transformation processes, that is solid, liquid, liquid gas, and a solid. Now we will talk more about on this equilibria, which is the equilibrium involving the dissolution of solid or gases in liquids. So now we will again talk about solid or liquid in gases. Equilibrium which involves dissolution means what? Dissolving. That's all. Dissolution means dissolving. So, the equilibrium involving the dissolution or dissolving solid in gas and liquid in gas. So, these two also we have to study in the physical equilibrium. Dissolution means if you dissolve, for example, say, first we will talk about solid in gas. Okay, so now we are studying equilibrium in solid, liquid in gases. So first we talk about solid in gases. Okay. You know, dissolution means dissolving. For example, if you have a beaker and if you have a water in it, a half filled beaker, you add sugar into it and you stir it, what happens? It will dissolve. That means a solid is dissolved in a liquid. That is the this case. Now we will see how equilibrium is happening in that. Correct. Okay. So we have a beaker, you have a half of filled with water, you are adding sugar into it, you stir it, it is dissolved. So we said, you will say the sugar is dissolved in water. You add more and more sugar, it will get dissolved. Then you increase the temperature. Then what happens? The dissolution is faster, isn't it? Or you can say you can add more sugar into it. So it will get dissolved. And it forms a saturated solution. Now what is a saturated solution? You know, saturated solution means a solution where no more solute can be added into it, because already the concentration of that solute is maximum for that solvent. So that you cannot add more sugar so that it will dissolve. So if you add solute to it, it won't dissolve, it will be like that solid. So at that particular that thing, you call it as a saturated solution. Okay. But that is that you call the solubility. That means something is the capability of dissolving something is called as a solubility. So when we increase the temperature, you can add more or you can dissolve more sugar in it. Now suppose you have a saturated solution of sugar, because that no more solute can be dissolved. You increase the temperature, you add it. Then you suddenly cool that solution. You got it? You have a solution, you increase the temperature, you dissolve more and more sugar into it, you get a saturated solution. Now what you have to do? You have to cool that solution at normal temperature, at room temperature. If you cool it, what happens? That is a point. If you cool that saturated solution at room temperature, you can see the crystals of salt is getting separated out. You can imagine, right? The crystals of salt is getting separated out when you cool that saturated solution. This happens only in saturated solution. Because saturated solutions means we are heating it and adding more and more sugar into it. But at normal temperature, the crystals of sugar will separate out, which is called as crystallization of that sugar. First, what you did, you dissolve the sugar, which means that dissolution of sugar. Got it? 2 points. Dissolution of sugar means you dissolve the sugar in the solution. Crystallization of sugar means the crystals of sugar is separated from that solution. Now, how the crystals will separate out? This, what happens? Equilibrium will be maintained between the two. That means this is a solid in solid and in gases. I'm really sorry. Solid and gases in liquids. Okay. So this is solid in liquid. Sorry. Solid and gases in liquids. So solid in liquids. Now what happens? You have sugar, isn't it? So you have sugar as solution. It is sugar solution. So this will be in equilibrium with what? Sugar in the solution. Sorry, this is the solution and this is the solid state. See? So sugar in the solution. That means sugar is there in the solution. Then sugar is crystallizing out. That is in the solid state. So this is a solid in liquid equilibrium. That is sugar solid is in equilibrium with sugar of solution. So what happens is the sugar in this solution, right? The sugar in the solution will collide with each other and it will crystallize out. So that is called as what? The crystallization. Dissolution means what? Dissolution means the dissolving of the sugar in the water. So at equilibrium, I can write the rate of dissolution. Correct. The rate of dissolution is equal to the rate of crystallization. Okay, so we can say the rate of dissolution is equal to the rate of crystallization. Okay, this can be verified by means of a simple experiment. Now, if you take simple sugar and dissolve it, you can't see that whether that sugar is gone into or into a solid state or something like that. We are assuming that this sugar is going into the solid state. But if you put some radioactive sugar, which means we can identify the radioactivity in that sugar. If you put some radioactive sugar in the saturated solution, after some time, we can see in the solution also you can have the radioactivities in the sugar, and also in the crystallization of the sugar particles also, in that also you can see the radioactive sugar. Got it? Which means what? Which means this, you have put the radioactive sugar only in that saturated solution. So after some time, if you examine this, you can see the radioactive sugar is also in the crystal sugar. Or when you examine the crystallization of this sugar, or sugar crystals being precipitated out or crystallizes out, in that sugar if you examine, you can also see the radioactive sugar in that also. Which means what? There is an equilibrium between, or this sugar is going into that and that sugar is going into this. That means the sugar from the solution is going into the sugar in the solid, and the sugar from the solid is coming into the sugar in the solution. That is what is called as solid liquid equilibrium. You got it? That means dissolution means what? Dissolving. Dissolving a solid in liquid. Dissolving a solid in liquid. So in that also, an equilibrium, a dynamic equilibrium happens, in which we can say the rate of dissolution, that is dissolving a sugar, is in equilibrium with the rate of crystallization of sugar. Got it? So this is the dissolution of solid in liquid. Hope it is clear. This is simple. You have a saturated solution. You make more saturated by increasing the temperature. Then if you cool that thing, you will get, or that sugar is crystallizes out. Okay, which means what? Which means the sugar in the solution is in equilibrium with the sugar in the solid state or in the crystallized sugar. So hope it is clear. Now we will see next gases in liquid. Gases in liquid, you know, everyone know, the best example is what? When you open a soda bottle or a Pepsi or a Fizzy or water bottle, what you can have a fizzy sound, isn't it? When you open a soda bottle or if you open a Pepsi or Linka or whatever, you will have a fizzy sound, isn't it? So what is that? So that we will see in gases in liquid. Okay. You know how this soda is prepared? How this soda is prepared or how this Pepsi is prepared and all. It's a carbonated liquid, right? Carbonated liquid. That means this liquid, then it will, the gases is put into this liquid under high pressure. The gases is getting dissolved into this liquid at high pressure. So that is why if you open it, the pressure is released. Inside it, it is high pressure. So when that soda bottle opened, what will happen? This pressure, the pressure is high inside the liquid. So that gases escape into the atmosphere. So atmosphere means there is a low pressure, atmospheric pressure. So what happens? This will, the gases will escape from this bottle to the atmospheric pressure. So there is a change in pressure. Correct. And that change in pressure, that is what we have hearing that fizzy sound. Got it? And after some time, that sound will be over, right? All the pressure gases will go into the atmosphere and make a new equilibrium with the atmospheric pressure. So inside the soda bottle, what happens? Inside the soda bottle, there is a liquid as well as a gas, isn't it? Because we if we have a soda bottle, you have water in that and there is a gas inside it. So these two makes it as soda, that you know. Now in that case, it's a closed container. So how we are making? You are dissolving these gases in under high pressure. Correct. So in that, if it is a closed container, this is soda. Soda means what? Water plus gas. See? Water plus gas under high pressure. See? Under high pressure, then only you can compress it, the gas, in that bottle. So under high pressure, you are making the soda. So soda water. Now, if you open this, so in this case, what happens? In this case, carbon dioxide is a gas which is you are giving it. Now, the carbon dioxide gas is in equilibrium with the carbon dioxide liquid, correct? That means what? The carbon dioxide gas is in the gaseous state, is in equilibrium with the carbon dioxide in solution, which means in the solution also there is carbon dioxide. Okay, and you know in the soda bottle it is not completely filled. There is some gap in that, isn't it? So that is the carbon dioxide gas is there. So there is an equilibrium between the carbon dioxide gas and the carbon dioxide which is in the liquid state, because we are dissolving this carbon dioxide gas in the liquid or in the water. Correct. Then only you will get the soda water. But in that case also, there is an equilibrium existing between the carbon dioxide gas. That means it is in the upside of the liquid. There is a space. So here the carbon dioxide gas is in equilibrium with what? The carbon dioxide liquid or the carbon dioxide which is in the solution. So here also there is an equilibrium existing between gases in liquid. The best example is soda water. Now what happens when you open it? So there is an equilibrium existing between these two. Okay, the carbon dioxide gas is in equilibrium with the carbon dioxide which is present in the solution. Now if you open the soda bottle, what happens? The carbon dioxide inside the soda bottle gets out. Isn't it? Now what happens? Outside the atmospheric pressure is low. There is one atmosphere. So what happens? This carbon dioxide now makes a new equilibrium with the atmospheric pressure which is very, very, very low. Correct. The carbon dioxide gas. So that is why we are getting a fizzy sound when you open a soda bottle. Clear? And this explanation is done by a law. You will study in 10th standard very, very detailed, which is called as Henry's law. Okay, and this dissolution of gases in liquids, the soda water, this can be explained by means of a Henry's law. And the law states that the mass of a gas dissolved in a given mass of solvent. Just imagine, a mass of a gas, what is the gas? Carbon dioxide, which is dissolved in a given mass of a solution, a given mass of water. So for example, 100 ml. A 100 ml water, you are taking 100 ml gas into it. Suppose. So the mass of the gas which is dissolved in a given mass of a solvent at any temperature, that means at a constant temperature, you take it as T as a constant, is directly proportional to the pressure of the gas above the solvent. That is what I told you. What is it? Henry's law states that, I will write it here. Henry's law states that the mass of a gas, okay, here the gas is carbon dioxide, the mass of a gas dissolved in a specific mass or a given mass of a solvent, okay, a given mass of a solvent, that is here it is water, carbon dioxide, it is that is dissolved in a given mass, not a specific, we can say it is a given mass of solvent, is directly at a given temperature, at a particular temperature or any temperature, is directly proportional to the pressure of the gas above the solvent, isn't it? The above the solvent. So it is directly proportional to the pressure of the gas, because anyway that there is a gas there and the gas is applying a pressure there. So the mass of the gas which is dissolved in a given mass of a solvent is directly proportional to the pressure of the gas above the solvent. Here indirectly they are saying the mass of the gas which is absorbed or which is there in the liquid, how many mass is there, that much pressure is there above the liquid. That is Henry's law. We can apply next year. We will study very detailed. We will study the Henry's law. Okay, so you got it. This is what is about the gas in liquid equilibrium. That means the carbon dioxide gas in the soda water is in equilibrium with the carbon dioxide in the liquid state. So in all these equilibria, what we have studied. What is it? In solid-liquid equilibria, at a particular temperature it is getting it. At this melting point or freezing point, the solid-liquid equilibrium happens. And the mass of that is constant. If you are not giving any exchange, any matter, the mass will be remain constant. And at constant pressure. That is the first thing. The second thing, in the liquid-vapor equilibria, the vapor pressure remains constant. See? In every equilibria, one measurable quantity is kept as a constant. That's what I said earlier. So, in liquid vapor equilibria, what happens? The vapor pressure is a constant. Okay. And the third is, in the dissolution of solid in liquid, that is sugar in the solution, what is kept constant? The solubility is kept constant because saturated solution, isn't it? You have taken saturated solubility. You kept the solubility as a constant. And in the dissolution of gas in liquid, what is it? The concentration of the gas in liquid is directly proportional to the pressure of the gas above the liquid. See what? So we are keeping the pressure there constant, the solubility getting constant, the temperature remains constant, the vapor pressure remains constant. So all this physical equilibria what we are studying, you are keeping one measurable quantity like pressure, temperature, solubility, vapor pressure, etc. One is kept as a constant and then you are giving the equilibrium. So this much is about the physical equilibria or equilibria involved in physical processes. The phase transformation as well as the dissolution of solid and gases in liquids. So hope you understood. So one thing I want to tell you is read the textbook thoroughly. Some examples are given. So going to the example, you will have a very good idea about it. Okay, so till then, thank you.